Hello and welcome to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Killett, your host. So happy to be here with you on this Monday. And I'm always happy to be back here on a Monday, but particularly happy this week, the holiest week of the year for Catholic people, for most Christian people around the world, although Holy Week will be celebrated on a different week by our Orthodox brothers and sisters, and even some Catholics in the East. So this week, for most Christians, however, we commemorate... Well, it's, you know, I want to say what we commemorate, but it's a lot of things we commemorate. The institution of the Eucharist and the first ordination of priests, and we bless oils and wash feet. But the primary thing is the death of Christ on the cross on Friday, which we remember as Good Friday, because this is the best good work ever done, this work that Christ did on our behalf so that we can be saved. And then, of course, Easter Sunday coming up. So we'll be with you as much as we can this week, of course, Thursday and Friday. If you listen on EWTN, there will be, they've got liturgies from around the world that they'll be bringing you. So make sure you tune in for those. To kind of begin Holy Week, a perfect time to talk with non-Catholics. So it's open forum for non-Catholics both hours today. If you're not a Catholic, this is the week when we welcome people into the church more than any other week as well. And so maybe you're thinking, well, maybe that's something for me. Maybe you're feeling the call into the full communion of the Catholic Church. Or maybe you're just interested. Maybe there's something you object to and you'd like to go that direction. We have two converts to the faith with us. Second hour, Tim Staples will be here. First hour, his website is catholicconvert.com. So you know he's a convert. Steve Ray is our guest. Steve, thanks so much for being here with us for this kind of special program.
Si. Yeah. So always glad to be here and join you guys. I like your show. I like Catholic Answers. I've been doing your shows for 25 years, well over 300 times, I think I've been on your show. Think of that. Over 25 years. And not only that, but writing magazine articles, and I've gone on a speaker on your pilgrimages and do the... I am very, very happy to associate with Catholic Answers, and I don't say that about all of the ministries out there.
Well, thank you, Steve. But think about that, 25 years, that means you've been at this pretty much as long as we've been at this. You know what I mean? That Catholic Answers Live is only 26 years old.
You're right. It has been about that long of a time, because I remember when Carl came out with his book, and I've been Catholic 30 years this May. I'll have been 30 years this May. We're Catholic, so it was just getting started when we converted. Today I just have a suggestion that since it's Holy Week, if people want to ask about where Jesus was today or Friday or what was going on in the Holy Land at the time and where he was and what happened, I'd be happy to do that too.
Thousands of people have gone with Steve and his wife to the Holy Land. And soon, by God's grace, that will begin again, and more trips to the Holy Land. That you can find out all about that at CatholicConvert.com. So if maybe you even got a, sometimes the interesting questions about this Holy Week are just geographic. Where is that?
Yes,
where is it when he goes to the garden at Gethsemane, and where is it when he goes to Bethany? And you can ask Steve whatever you like. 888-318-7884. You just got to not be a Catholic. It's open forum for non-Catholics today. 888-318-7884. Lines filling up, but two lines open, so you are welcome to make use of one of those. I'll start with Chuck in Cleveland, Ohio, watching on YouTube. Chuck, welcome. Go ahead with your question for Steve Ray.
Hey, Cy. Hey, Mr. Ray. I don't think you and I have talked before. I used to call it quite a bit on Catholic Answers. But, okay, so open forum. I am what you would call a Protestant. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. Sure.
Yeah.
Oh, that's great. Okay.
We almost hung up when you said Protestant, but we decided, no, we'll keep them.
Thank you for your graciousness.
Oh, you're very welcome.
I appreciate that. Yeah. So, I talked to a number of Roman Catholics on the floor level, on the layman level or something like that, and then I've talked to apologists. Not that you guys apologize for your faith, but, I think you know what I mean. So I'm going to ask you, and I'm curious about your answer because you're another person I'm going to talk to. But I'll put two questions, which is really the same singular question, to enter into heaven. So it goes like this: you're at the gate of heaven. And the person, I don't know, maybe it's St. Andrew or somebody like that at the gate, I don't know. So they ask you, why should I let you in? What are you depending upon to get into heaven? What are you depending upon that you are now right with God? So
yes,
there's two possibilities. Okay, so one is, well, I'm depending upon my water baptism, and I remained in the state of grace by my cooperation. I'm just so glad that I cooperated and I just did my best. And if I did commit a mortal sin, I cooperated to get back in the state of grace. Or is it what I'm depending upon to get into heaven? It's Christ and his righteousness, full stop. So those are, or maybe there's a flavor of that. Okay. So
I think we got
you,
Chuck.
Tell me what. Okay, that's good. Yeah.
Yeah. Go ahead, Steve.
Thank you.
Well, I would say, first of all, I would not get into the either or aspect. I would say both and. If you ask me flat out, I use this example, if somebody's in a car accident and they've got 1 minute to live and they're laying in the ditch and they say, quick, Steve, how do I get to heaven? I would say it's very simple. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him should not perish and have everlasting life. And then I jump to Acts 16:31, where the Philippian jailer asks Paul the same thing. And Paul says, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved. So this very simple view, if I only have 5 minutes to tell somebody, the answer is very simple. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. My salvation is based totally and completely on the grace of God. I am unworthy of salvation. It is his grace. And we're coming up to Holy Week here in the Catholic Church, and his death and resurrection and the blood that was shed. Just like the Passover lamb in the Old Testament, it was that blood that caused the lamb, the angel of death, to pass over them. And it's the blood on the beams of wood. The Old Testament, it was on the door frames. Today, it's still on the beams of wood. It's on the upper, the vertical and horizontal beams of the wood. So basically, I would say, if it was one word, totally grace. Second of all, I'd say John 3:16 and Acts 31. And then if I find out the person has really a whole day to live and they're not going to die after all, then we would develop that a little bit more.
Chuck, makes sense?
Well, okay, so if it's not like, you know, I got 5 minutes to live, but in your case, because you've been a Roman Catholic for 30, 31 years or something like that, so then that would not be the answer then? It would be, I place
no, that's the answer.
And
that's what you want me to say, I know, because I used to be a Baptist evangelist, and I know how I used to preach and what I used to say about the Catholics who think they're going to get to heaven by their works. And Catholics do not believe they get to heaven by their works. They believe that we get to heaven based on the sheer gratuitous grace of God. And once we have faith in him, based on what he's done for us, then there are certain things required of us. And then we would discuss what that is. But the thief on the cross, he didn't get baptized. There's a lot of things that he couldn't do. But then again, he didn't present the gospel the way that you would or that I would either. Jesus didn't say, believe on me and you will have life. He just said, he says, you're an innocent man. I'm a guilty man. And Jesus said, you'll be with me in paradise. There's no Protestant version of the gospel message preached to him by Jesus that were given when he's on the cross, and yet he was promised to be with him in heaven. So the gospel is God works in different people's lives in different ways, and he's one example, and Adam and Eve are another example, are the saints of the Old Testament. They didn't have John 3:16 to fall back on. They were believing forward that there was going to be a Messiah and that they obeyed God and they trusted him. And you look at Abraham's life, you find that he had both faith. Genesis 15:6, it says that he believed God and it was counted to him as righteousness. But we also see in James chapter 2 where it says that he was justified when he offered up his son Isaac. So it's not easy it's very nice to come up with these little sound bites that make the gospel sound like they're very simplistic, very simple. But there is, but the gospel is simple. Like I said, it's John 3:16, Acts 16:31. But then you develop it more, and there's things required of us. I just read you one verse here. In Colossians, Paul writes, and he says, God has now reconciled in his body by his body of flesh by his death, in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before God, if indeed you continue in the faith, stable and steadfast, not shifting from the hope of the gospel from which you heard. So here we've got a big word, if. It's only two letters, but it's a pretty big word. Now, that's not saying that you're not saved by faith. We would not say faith alone, but we would say that we are saved by faith. Baptism comes into it too, because Jesus says in John 3:5 that you're saved by water and spirit. And it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out what that is, because the day before, still in the headlines of the Jerusalem Post, Jesus had gone down into the water and the Spirit had come down. And the next day he says to Nicodemus, water and spirit, and you're born again. And 1 Peter 3:21 says, baptism now saves you. So it's not a simple, if I have 1 minute, it's very simple. But there's more to the gospel than just faith alone.
Chuck, I'm going to leave it there because we are up to the break now. Thank you very much for getting us started. Lots of folks on the line. Just one line open now. It's open forum for non-Catholics today, and we have two converts to the Catholic faith. Second hour, Tim Staples. This hour, Steve Ray. Call with your questions. If you're not a Catholic, 888-318-7884.
Catholic Answers Live.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects homebuyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
EWTN is now on Twitter. Get short, timely messages from EWTN on your computer or cell phone. It's easy to stay up to date on a wide variety of topics. Pro-life news, Vatican announcements, catechesis, apologetics, the latest EWTN programming, and more. You can link to EWTN on Twitter from our homepage or go to twitter.com/EWTN. At work, at home, at school, and on the road, stay connected to your world with EWTN's Twitter page.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host. It's almost the end of March, and as I've been saying, at the end of this month, our Catholic Answers Canada cruise, the cabins that we have reserved and the discount price will go away at the end of this month. I think you could still go, but then you'd have to pay whatever the cruise company is charging for the cabins. And so if you'd like to find out about the cruise, go to CatholicAnswersCruise.com. We're leaving from Montreal on June 29th. We'll hit Quebec. We'll hit Nova Scotia. We'll hit Maine, Boston, and points in between. And you are welcome to come. We also have wonderful speakers. Father Paul Keller will be our priest. We'll have Mass each day. Dr. Amy Fahey, Dr. William Fahey will be guest speakers. Joe Heschmeyer, Chris Check, and I will be there, and we'll do the flannel panel radio program from the boat. I guess you're supposed to say ship. From the ship, June 29th through July 6th on the Holland America lines. Just go to CatholicAnswersCruise.com. Use the promo code LAST150. LAST150. Because this is your last opportunity to get the $150 off any ticket that you purchase. Last 150 at CatholicAnswersCruise.com. Our guest this hour is a traveling man. As a matter of fact, I was asking him for travel tips. I don't know how to travel like Steve Ray knows how to travel. He's been to the Holy Land. I believe the last count was
over 200 times.
Holy smokes. You've been to the Holy Land more than the apostles. but their first time there was very long. If you want to talk about the Catholic faith and you are not a Catholic, Steve is a convert to the Catholic faith, and you are welcome to call 888-318-7884. Just before I go to the phone, back to the phone, Steve, what are you doing now that the Holy Land is really not a place to travel to? What are you, a lot of backgammon or what?
Well, I would go to the Holy Land. I wouldn't hesitate to go myself, but I couldn't get anyone to go with me right now because of the situation. And Delta's not even flying to to Israel until June 6th. I had two trips in May that we had to postpone. But I'm leaving next week with a group to Lourdes and Fatima. And we've got a good busload of people there. We set up one for Wisconsin with Cardinal Burke and seeing the shrines of Wisconsin.
Oh, great.
We have one now at the end of November, the Saints and Shrines of France. We got also a St. Paul cruise. You guys are going through Canada. We're going up around Turkey and Rome, Turkey, and Greece, much more extensive. And then we've got Ireland we're doing too this summer. So we are filling it in with other places until Israel. We're hoping to go back in the fall. We've already got people signing up for the fall and winter to
Very
go
good.
To Israel.
Have they got some Catholic things in Ireland?
Well, a couple
of them.
They're losing it quick, though, so we're going back there to remind them.
Yeah, well, yes.
Of what they have.
That happens. Steve's here in California listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. Steve, thank you for your call. Go ahead and talk with Steve.
Hey, guys. Thanks, Si.
Oh, hey, Steve.
Just wondering if you could help an old Protestant like you, Steve, that's trying to understand his way into the church. I've got an old Zondervan Archaeological Study Bible, and I need a Catholic replacement.
I don't know of any distinctly Catholic archaeological Bibles, but there's a lot of good ones, and I'll just show you a couple. They told me you're going to do this, so I've got this one. It's called Zondervan. That might be the one that you have, because that's I use different ones, and I don't know of any that are specifically Catholic. There's another one here called Archaeological Study Bible English Standard Version. This might be somewhat Catholic, or at least objective. There's another one, New International Version. This is called the Archaeological Study Bible. Those are one. And I would really recommend getting this, too. It's called the Didache Bible, put out by Ignatius Press. It's my favorite Bible right now that I recommend everybody. And all the footnotes are really good from the Catechism and other things. Now, I wrote an article for Catholic Answers in their magazine, and I'm hoping that they can help you locate it. But it was called The Stones Cry Out, and it was quite a lengthy article I wrote from a very Catholic perspective on archaeology and how archaeological discoveries are confirming Scripture and the history of the Catholic Church, when a lot of people in the past denied that the Bible was true and that archaeology would confirm it. But the more discoveries they make, the more it confirms all the things that we believe about Jesus really lived and all of these things. And there's really a Pontius Pilate, all these things. So I don't have a specific study Bible that's Catholic that I can think of off the top of my head. But if they give you my email address, I'll be happy to share some of the books that I have and the link to my article on The Stones Cry Out about archaeology.
All right, hang on, Steve. Today on the phones, Jordan is covering the phones with us. Jordan, thanks for being here. Just hang on, Jordan will get the information. We'll get your email address to send to Steve. Thanks.
And Steve, I just want to say, congratulations to you. I love a guy like you who is ready to learn new things and discover new things. And once you become Catholic, you'll never look back. And God bless you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Steve. All right, off we go to Bellevue, Nebraska, where Ricky is listening on our app. Oh, no, on our website, Catholic.com. Ricky, welcome. It's open forum for non-Catholics with Steve Ray this hour. Go ahead with your question for Steve.
Hey, Si, and Jerusalem Jones. It's a pleasure to get to talk to you for the first time. Steve, my question is, I just recently purchased your book, Upon the Cross. I'm hoping to read that sometime this year. But my question is, how does one become a but avoid kind of a triumphalistic better attitude? And what I mean by that is, in my studies and investigation here, you know, I've listened to a lot of dialogue, debates, and I see polemics on both sides of the pews, really. And I tend to see a lot of Catholics with that mentality of, you know, the one true church, and this is the church that Jesus Christ established. But with where I'm at in my investigation, I'm trying to be really humble about it and, you know, just take the approach of, hey, if I ever became a Catholic, it's because I just think the evidence points in that direction.
Yeah.
So I don't know if I could ever truly say, like, oh, without a doubt, this is the church that he established, but more so, I think the evidence points in that direction. So does, hopefully
it can make sense to you. I think when you read that book, Upon This Rock, you'll be more close to saying you're pretty sure, pretty certain about it, because there's a historical track record. And what church fits with what Scripture teaches and anticipates. And so anyway, I jokingly say, and this is just a joke, it's tongue in cheek, it's really hard to be humble when you're a Catholic. That's just a joke. What I mean by that is I came a long way from being a Baptist and an evangelical Protestant to discover the Catholic Church. And I also say that it's, I think, the best kept secret in the world. And once you discover it, it's like Jesus saying that you find a pearl or a precious stone in a field, you immediately go buy the whole field so that you will own that gift, that great precious stone that you found. And that's kind of how I consider the church. So it's not hard to be, to avoid triumphalistic, because I know I'm a sinner and the church is a great gift. But I said to my wife when we were joining, if the church was perfect, and as soon as I join it, it's not going to be perfect anymore, because I know myself. And I feel like a leper coming to Jesus to be embraced and healed. How can I be triumphalistic when I know that I'm a sinner and everything I have is totally by grace? I don't deserve any of it. It's kind of hard to, and that the church has been here 2,000 years. I didn't bring it here. I didn't get it started. I don't keep it here. Jesus said he would build his church. So it's kind of, I found Jesus. I'm pretty triumphalistic about that. I'm very happy I found him. And I don't mind saying I know I found the right thing. But then if Jesus started a church, and it actually is a not just a ethereal thing where it's just brothers and sisters that love each other and, hey, let's get together on Sunday morning and pray and sing together. But it really is a government, which I could go on and on. You'll see it in my book on Upon This Rock, but I wish we had time to talk more about it. But you'll, as you study it, I came to conclude that it was the church. And so I'm happy to be a member of it. I know I'm in the right place, but I'm not proud in a bad way about it or triumphalistic, because I know that it's a gift, and it's hard to be triumphalistic when it's something's been given to you and you don't deserve it.
Does that help you, Ricky? You were just a little bit clipped before, Ricky. So I just want to check back in with you and see if that was helpful to you.
Yeah, it was. It's one of the things I'm still kind of struggling with in regards to kind of, you know, being ecumenical if I did become Catholic towards friends and family that I know aren't Catholic, and being able to reach them in a way that's not, you know, hey, I'm a part of the one true church and you're not. So, you know,
well, comment on that? When we became Catholics, I probably was a little more that way than I should have been. But my parents and my wife's parents, mine because of theology, my parents had been Baptist converts in 1953. From nothing, they became Baptists and were just gung-ho. And then my wife, her family, she's the first Catholic in over 400 years. They came from the Hussites in the Czechoslovakia area. And when we became Catholic, without saying hardly anything, they totally disowned us. They wouldn't have anything to do with us. If you do become Catholic, just your attitude talking to you today, I don't think you have any problem with being triumphalistic or being putting off other people. The general thing that's going to happen, my guess is that people will come after you, that they won't accept you because you've made this decision to be Catholic, no matter how you present it. But I can't see you, just in the short time I've talked to you, you sound like a great guy and a very magnanimous and ecumenical kind of a guy. And I can't see you burning bridges or making enemies. And there's a way to, I wrote an article, 6 Rules for Dealing with Non-Catholic Family and Friends. And the first two are, don't argue with them and love them more than you ever loved them before. And that means I don't go starting arguments with these people. And but then if they do come and ask questions, then you honestly share with them maybe just your testimony of why you became a Catholic. What are the arguments that convinced you without condemning them? Because if you push someone, the natural reaction is they're going to push you back. But I can't imagine with the attitude you have that that will happen. I think you'll do fine.
We have a secret weapon too, Ricky. It's called monthly confession. That keeps you a little humble if you got to confess your sins once a month. We got to take a very quick break. If not a Catholic and you got questions about the Catholic faith, we got the perfect guy this hour. CatholicConvert.com is his website. It's Steve Ray. Give a call, 888-318-7884. As we read the Gospels, every Christian faces the question again and again, what does Jesus mean? Getting the answer right is critical to both growth in holiness and fruitful evangelization. Want to know Jesus better so you can introduce him to your friends? Then it's time to get serious about understanding his words. Why not join Catholic Answers for our 10th annual Apologetics Conference? Learn from me the parables, sermons, and conversations of Jesus Christ, September 26th through 29th, right here in sunny San Diego. Learn from our guests, Dr. Scott Hahn and Kimberly Hahn, Dr. Ray Guarendi, Father Sebastian Walsh, Billy Junker, Father Paul Check, and, of course, all of your favorite Catholic Answers apologists. It'll be 4 days of fun, faith, fellowship, and a live radio show. Seats are still available, but going fast, visit CatholicAnswersConference.com or call 1-888-291-8000 today.
Our Lord needs articulate defenders of the truth to spread the joy of the Catholic faith. Catholic Answers Monthly Giving Club, Society 315, helps you fulfill the call in 1 Peter 3:15 to always be prepared to make a defense for the hope that is in you. For as little as $10 a month, you'll help Catholics grow in faith, bring lapsed Catholics home, and lead non-Catholics to the truth. Go to CASociety315.com and join today.
When it comes to Catholic teachings about Mary, there's one question we hear more than any other. Where is that in the Bible? The answer? Everywhere. In Bible Mary, the Mother of Jesus and the Word of God, Father John Weiss opens Scripture to reveal a Mary who has been hiding in plain sight. Order your copy of Bible Mary today at shop.catholic.com or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live, Monday of Holy Week. Thank you for being here with us. Hey, it's an open forum for non-Catholics, and I should tell you that if you are not a Catholic, you are welcome at Catholic services, Holy Thursday, Good Friday, and Easter Sunday. Easter Vigil, we call it. That's the night before Easter. That's a long one, but maybe the most beautiful liturgy in the church's year. Many people find it that it is, but it'll be hours that you'll be there. You can just call your local parish or usually on their website. The Catholic parishes are finally figuring out what a website is for. There used to be all kinds of nonsense before you could figure out when the masses are. But most Catholic parishes have figured out the reason people are looking is they want to know what time is confession, what time is mass. So it's not too hard these days. A few years ago, it was very frustrating. Seven letters from the bishop, three letters from the pastor, something from the, you know, and then where's mass times? But they figured it out. I don't know if you noticed that, Steve. It used to be so frustrating. It's like
when you go to the webpage now, it's right there front and center.
Yeah. So you're welcome. Yeah. We're happy to have you there. They'll be pretty full, but we'd love it if you'd come. Right now, it's open forum for non-Catholics. 888-318-7884 is the number. We're going to Saline, Texas. Sandra is listening on 1060 AM. Sandra, welcome. Go ahead with your question for Steve.
Thank you for having me. So I am not Catholic.
Okay.
From a home that had Catholic parents. About 30 years ago, a sibling died, and it kind of took my parents away from the church.
Oh.
And I'm going to cry in a minute. This past year, I have drastically felt the need for communion.
Oh, yes. Okay.
Very bad.
Yep.
I'm in my third marriage. So, you know, how do I go about this? I feel like I'm just going to be told, no, you're welcome, but you'll never receive communion.
Oh,
that's not necessarily true, Sandra.
No, not at all. The church is very merciful. All of us have issues. And a third marriage, just so you'll know why the church handles marriage so seriously is because it's a covenant between, God has made a covenant with us, and he takes covenants very seriously. And in the beginning, it was a man and a woman, and it was a covenant for life. But the church is merciful in the sense that it knows that a lot of people get married without knowing that truth, without being Catholic. You came up in a home where there was a death in a family and your family left the Catholic Church, and you probably grew up not knowing all of these things. And it's easy when you're a youngster to get married and not know what you're doing, and get divorced and marry someone else and not be happy about it, but it happens. And then you come to the Catholic Church. Now, were you baptized as a Catholic?
No, I was not.
See, okay. If you're not baptized as a Catholic, then it's a whole lot easier for you, from what I understand. I'm not a canon lawyer or a priest on this matter, but if you were never baptized a Catholic, that makes things easier for you. What you need to do is go find a good priest in a parish near you and just go cry on his shoulder like you just started to do. I'm telling you, I don't mind, because I tear up all the time about the Catholic Church. I'll tell you this, Sandra. I cried at every Mass for the first 6 years. My wife and I both did. Every Mass, we cried. It was so, and I understand what you mean, that you need the Eucharist. You want to come back to Jesus in the church. And the church is merciful, and the church wants you to come back, and the church wants to make a way for you to do that. But there are those in the church, in a parish near you, who deal with these issues, who know the ins and outs of them and how to help you so that you can get into that position. So that's what I would recommend. Find a good parish. If you go there and the priest isn't sympathetic and he's not friendly, just say thank you very much and go find one that is. I hate to say that, but not all priests are easy to deal with. Most of them are today. Most of them are going to they're going to be very happy that you have this
spirit in this season of special grace. The number is 888-318-7884. If you're not a Catholic, it's open forum for non-Catholics. Steve Ray, a convert to the Catholic faith. He came to Christianity, and I always love to remember this fact about Steve. He came to Christianity because of a fella you might have heard of before. Steve, you heard, was it on television, or you didn't go to the mission? You heard on television.
Al Cresta?
I was talking about becoming a Christian with Billy Graham.
Oh, yeah. My parents became Christians in 1953. They were just pagans, never had no church upbringing at all. 1953, Billy Graham came to Detroit. My mom heard him on the radio, and my mom fell on her knees and just prayed and said, God save me, like that man on the radio just said. She had no idea. She knew nothing.
Wow.
But God had mercy on her. And my dad thought he had cancer and was dying, and he went out on the front porch at night at the same time and said, if there's a God, I don't even know if you're up there, but if there's a God, reveal yourself to me. And my dad went to work the next morning. 12 hours later, and a man came up and said, Charlie, you need Jesus Christ in your life, and told my dad about Jesus. And that all was 1953. They had 12 years of miscarriages, and my mom said, now that we found Jesus, would you please give us children? And I was born a year later.
Isn't that beautiful? And God is so good.
Yeah, and so, and then I heard Billy Graham, 17. See, I'm 70 years old. I will be this year. I'll be 70. And so I grew up in the late 60s and early 70s when all the craziness was going on in our country, the Beatles, rock and roll, and all that got started. Well, anyway, I had long hair. I know you can't believe it now, Si, but I had long hair like a lion's mane, bell-bottom blue jeans. I was a rebellious hippie kid. But when I was 17 years old, I heard Billy Graham on the radio. My mom had him on. And it just hit me like a ton of bricks. And then George Beverly Shea came on with his deep baritone voice and started singing, "Just as I am without one plea, but that your blood was shed for me." I ran out the back door. I did not want my parents to see me affected by Billy Graham. But that night at 17, I looked up into the sky and I just said, "Jesus, I'm a rebellious 17-year-old kid, but tonight I'm going to give my whole life to you."
Praise
that was
God.
The most important moment in my life. I get choked up every time I tell it. But that set the trajectory for my life. And I'll end it by saying this. At 17 years old, Jesus introduced himself to me in a personal way. And when I was 39, he says, "Now it's time to meet my family."
Oh, what a beautiful story, Steve. Hey, maybe that's your story. If you are not a Catholic yet and you'd like to ask a question about the Catholic faith, 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. Brian is in Chicago, Illinois, watching on YouTube. Brian, welcome. Go ahead with your question for Steve Ray.
Hello, Brian.
Hi, Steve. This is Steve in Chicago here. My point about the Catholic teachings. I was listening for a few episodes like this, with the apologists were saying that your God is not held to the same moral standards that we would have with any other moral being, and that you guys teach that, and because it's a God, it's not accountable to stewardship or consent in a moral relationship with us. And by teaching that we have to have two separate moral sets of books for this God and for people, this relationship that you're teaching, a moral relationship with this God, mirrors exactly what would be in an abusive spouse relationship, for how they would justify abusing their own partner, because that partner in power isn't accountable to the person that they have to be a steward to. So how is this actually good for society that you teach this? Why isn't this God?
Well, first of all, I have no idea who would have said that or said that God is not accountable. That sounds to me like the God of Islam, which is the difference between the two. And I would say this just as a comparison. The God of Islam is, he's viewed as pure will. He can do whatever he wants. He's not accountable to anybody. And he just has pure will. In the Catholic tradition, what we believe is that God is love, and that God is, he is, it is accountable. He can't make a square a circle. He's made the universe the way it is, and he has created even a covenant relationship with us as Christians, which is the relationship of a loving husband or father for his children. And I don't know where you would get the idea that we have two sets of standards. Now, I could say he is the creator, and as a creator, and Paul makes this point in Romans 9, 10, and 11, if I make something, I can also smash it. If I made it, and I made it in its mind, and I created it, I can smash it. But God loves us in the fact that he made us in his own image. He said that he made us in his image. And even God loved us enough that he came down here. Two of the verses of the Bible I memorized as a youngster was, "In the beginning was the Word," which is Jesus, "and the Word was with God, the Father, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us." That he cared about us so much that he came down and actually became one of us so he could experience as a human what we experience, and actually to lay his life down for us, to pay for our sins and our shortcomings. So I don't know how we'd get this idea that God has one set of standards and we have another. We're actually made in his image, and he is our model of correct conduct.
Okay. Well, you just said that God is by definition love. So therefore, you're not allowed to ever morally assess it as anything other than love. And so, therefore, that's
not
the
more,
abuser.
Wait, I didn't understand that. Say that again. I'm not morally allowed to what?
If you define somebody as a moral label, by definition, they could never be anything other than that label. That removes any true moral assessment of the person. They are by default only that. That is what the abuser teaches the person they've abused, that I am in power, I am love, anything I do, you just have to misinterpret why I smacked you today for not wiping off the countertop properly, because I'm loving you. You're just misinterpreting this as abuse.
Okay, to smack somebody for loving, for not setting the table right, is certainly not love. Nobody, I would not know, no Christian I know of would ever say that that's the case. When it talks about a husband and a wife in relationship to Jesus and his church, it says that a husband should treat his wife. The number one condition of a husband relationship to his wife is that he should lay down his life in love for his wife. Why? Because God laid down his life for us, and we are to follow the way he does things. Now, I raised 4 children, and I have 20 grandchildren now. And if you ask them, they'd say, Grandpa is love. Grandpa loved us. Grandpa showed love. But then they would also say that I disciplined them, because they needed to be disciplined at times in order for me to raise them to be responsible human beings. And I couldn't, love does not mean nice. If you say that love is a synonym for being nice, no, it's not. Because if I discipline my children, and I always did it out of love, I never smacked my kid, I never, anything like that. That's not love, that's anger, that's wrath, that's sinful. So God is love, but he's also, you can't say he's just love, he's also justice, and he's also merciful. Mercy is his greatest quality, by the way. He will do things for us and love us and forgive us even when we're not deserving of it. So I'm not sure where you get the idea that we have a God who has a separate rule book for himself than for us, because everything that is taught in the Catholic Church is that God is love and justice and mercy and transcendent, but he loves us so much that he's willing to give his own life for us. And when we sinned against him, he didn't just wipe us off the face of the earth. He came down and gave his whole life to redeem us.
Brian, thank you. I hope that call was helpful for you. I'm going to try to get everybody on that I can before the end of this hour. Tim Staples will be here second hour. So if we do not get to your call by the end of this hour, just hang on. Tim will be here second hour and we'll continue. Open forum.
Can I make one comment, Cy?
Yes.
A lot of times when I find people that have a problem with God or with this kind of thing about God being a wrathful God or having a separate, it almost always is there's been a problem with that person and their father. You know, in other words, I get a lot of people ask me, say they can't love God or they never feel forgiven or anything. And I ask them, what is the relationship you have with your father? And almost 95% of the times they say, my father was abusive, or my father ignored me, or my father left and I didn't have a father. And that's why then when we pray, our Father who art in heaven, we see our earthly dad in that, and we transpose our Father to the Heavenly Father, and we see him as different than he really is. I don't know. I don't want to say that man had that problem. I'm just saying that a lot of times that's the case.
Again, Brian, thank you for the call. Open forum for non-Catholics, 888-318-7884. Going to Florida, Hayden is in Florida watching on YouTube. Hayden, welcome. Go ahead with your question for Steve Ray.
Hello. Thank you for having me. I was very recently looking into the Catholic faith from a Protestant background, and so I wanted to clear things up, and I wanted to ask, how does the relation of purgatory and us praying for them or paying the church, how does that relate to the people in purgatory going through that purification process?
Okay,
this is really interesting, Hayden, because just yesterday I was in Florida in Jacksonville and I gave a talk on purgatory. Now I'm back up here in Michigan in the snow again. But that is crazy, and what are the chances of that happening? But I explained in my talk that purgatory is like the front porch of heaven, and the people in purgatory, and I want to get specifically to your question, the church views us all as a big family, and those who are saints ahead of us have done many good things, and God rewards us for the good things that we do. There is merit involved. Even a Protestant, I used to say that the more good things we do down here, the more diamonds we'll have in our crown when we get in heaven. So even though I didn't say that we had to work, do those good works to get to heaven, I wouldn't say that now either. But the fact was, is that the more good works we did, it accrued to us in a sense as rewards. The way the Catholic Church views it is we're a big family, and the people in purgatory are being purged, and we can pray for their assistance. We can actually share our merit or the merits of the saints in heaven with them as a family would. Say, my friend next door is broke. He lost his job, not having money. So I have an excess. I can give that excess to him, and that helps him along the way. And I think that's in a way the same way that you could view purgatory, is that we, you know, another thing is got to remember is that purgatory isn't a second chance. It's not that, you know, when I was a Protestant, I used to say this, that purgatory is the Catholic second chance. If they fail in life, they get another chance in purgatory to get there. But that's not the case. Here's how I view purgatory really quickly, because I know the time is short, is that I lived in Switzerland for a year, and I didn't have much money, my wife and I and our kids. And we lived in a chalet in the Alps, and I wanted to see Rome. My wife says, go hitchhike down to Rome and see Rome and Venice and Florence. I'll take care of the kids, come back. And I did that, but I didn't have any money. I hitchhiked all the way. I slept on park benches. I never took a shower. I never brushed my teeth, anything. I was just moving. I was running, actually, to see all these things. And I got back to the chalet a week later, and I was filthy. I had slept on park benches and under viaducts on highways. My wife opened the door. I was home. I was back with my family. I was home. But my wife opened the door, and she looked at me, and she slammed the door in my face. And she came back with a bucket of water and a towel and soap. And she says, you take your clothes off on the porch and you clean yourself up. And when you're cleaned up, I'll let you come in. So I stood there naked in front of with the windows there with the cows and the farmers, all this in Switzerland. And I'm washing and scrubbing up. Finally, the door opened and I came in and I was home. I've said that gave me a good view. Purgatory is the front porch of heaven. That's what purgatory is, a front porch of heaven. I'm already home. I belong. I'm where I go. But I have to get cleaned up a little bit, purified a little more. Because in Hebrews 14:12, it says, attain peace with all men and attain holiness, without which you will never see the Lord. In other words, it's not just my sins need to be forgiven, but I need to be purged of my self-love and of my lust and of my sins that are in me and cleansed. And that's what purgatory does. It means to purge. And my wife helped me along the way. She brought out the bucket and the water. She helped me in that process of purification so that I could actually come in and be part of the family. I count on purgatory because I know that I'm not perfect yet. I'm not completely holy. And I know if I die tonight, I'm glad. I count on purgatory because it's going to get me the rest of the way.
That'll bring us to the end of this hour. As I said, if you're on the line, stay on the line. You can dial during the break. We'll get you on with Tim Staples coming up. It's open forum for non-Catholic. 888-318-7884. If you're not a Catholic and you've got a question about the faith, whether it's just a casual interest or maybe even a challenging question, you are welcome to call 888-318-7884. Steve Ray has been our guest. You can check out his work and maybe take a trip with them at CatholicConvert.com. Steve Ray, thank you. It's always such a great pleasure.
Thank you, Cy. I love it. The time goes so fast. I love talking with you and all of these wonderful folks. So God bless you, and we'll talk again in 2 months.
Okay. Blessed Holy Week, Steve. Right back with Tim after this. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. As promised, Tim Staples in studio with us on this Monday of Holy Week. Some people are off this week, and if maybe you're just discovering us, Catholic Answers is what we call an apologetics ministry or apostolate. You can find out about us by going to catholic.com. If this is your first time listening, you should know that anybody's welcome to call almost any day, but today it's open forum just for non-Catholics. We'd love to talk to those non-Catholics who have a question or a difficulty or whatever, an obstacle or just a curiosity, anybody. And non-Catholic is everyone that's not Catholic. So if you are like, I don't know, am I Catholic? If you have to ask, you're not. 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. 884. Ask whatever you like. Tim Staples is senior apologist here at Catholic Answers, the author of Behold Your Mother, a Biblical and Historical Defense of the Marian Doctrines, and a world-renowned speaker. He is renowned around the world for his speaking. Tim Staples, welcome.
Hey, can I disagree with you on your little opening there?
What did I say wrong?
He gets nervous when I say that.
I know, because you don't know how often I say something wrong. Like, I have to be corrected a lot.
No, you said if you don't know whether you're Catholic or not, you're not.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Now, that is not technically true.
I see what you're saying, yes.
Because if you are baptized Catholic, there is a sense in which you are once Catholic, always Catholic.
Yeah, right.
But we need to come to the fullness of the faith and understand what it means to be Catholic, right?
Yes, exactly.
You know me. I just get persnickety sometimes.
I think that's a very good clarification, because a lot of people don't actually know that. And I was just trying to make it as wide open as it can be. You know, feel welcome to call.
Amen. It is a beautiful thing to know that if you are baptized Catholic, and it doesn't matter how far away from the faith you have gotten, how far you have roamed, all you have to do is come see a priest.
And you're, yeah. Right.
And sometimes you need to make a formal profession of faith for those who have gotten far away. But for most, it's just a matter of going to confession.
Yeah. Yeah.
And being reestablished and rekindled, and come on home.
Come on.
It's a wonderful big old family of about 1.3 billion.
And we need 1.3 billion plus one, and yes. You're the one. 888-318-7884 is the number to call. But actually, you said you're persnickety, but that's important, because if you don't say it the way that you said it, then that suggests that the sacraments are not doing what we say they do, and they do exactly what the Church says they do.
Amen. Theology matters, doesn't it?
Yes, it does. It does indeed. And the Church says baptism makes you a Catholic, and it's permanent. That mark on you is permanent.
Doesn't mean you're going to heaven now.
No,
because we do not believe in one saint. See, now one thing leads to another, doesn't it, Cy Kelly? Right?
Yeah.
Because you're baptized, you are born again, born from above, as Jesus said, or in St. John's Gospel, John chapter 3, verse 3, doesn't mean you're guaranteed to go to heaven. And why is that? Because we receive the grace of our blessed Lord, whereby we enter into Jesus Christ, but we must choose to remain in him. And as Jesus said in Revelation chapter 2, verse 10, we must be faithful unto death. Then he will give us the crown of life.
888-318-7884. So in addition, I suppose, to trying to widen the circle as wide as possible of the number of Catholics, we would like to make the Catholic section in hell as small as possible.
Amen.
I want to reduce the size of that section.
And we'd like to make the hell section of hell
smaller.
As small as possible. Amen.
888-318-7884. You want to talk about any speaking you got coming up? Anything you want to... Or are you just home?
Yeah, just the one coming up in April. And
oh, I know what you're talking about. In Omaha, you're going to...
No, this is in Ohio.
Oh, the marriage one in Ohio.
One. Yes. My wife and I are doing a tag team. Actually, it's a wonderful marriage conference. And man, looking into it, and Val's all fired up. She's getting that talk.
She's a good speaker, too. I remember when she filled in for you one time.
She's really got it. She's got her talk. down. And there's going to be a whole lot of speakers. It's going to be a large conference, but it's a marriage conference. We're celebrating the sacrament of holy matrimony. You're going to have talks. You're going to have, you know, interaction, small groups, and a candlelight dinner in the evening. So it is going to be a glorious day. Did you happen to find it on our website?
I'm still looking. Is it in Cleveland? What city is it in?
I wish I could remember.
I'm going to find it.
I had the sheet sitting right on my desk, and once again, I forgot to carry it down the hall. You know, it's a big thing. Jen tells me, carry this piece of paper down the hall, Tim, and read from it.
I will find it, though. I'll tell you what. We'll do a call, and then we go to the break, I will have the information on how you can come to the marriage conference.
At the break, I'll run down and get that piece of paper.
Okay. All right. So let's see who we got first here. We are going to Zach in Colorado, listening to EWTN on Channel 130, Sirius XM Satellite Radio. Zach, welcome. Go ahead with your question for Tim Staples.
Hey, thanks for taking my call. Yes. I'm wondering how to answer a friend who wants to know the church's teaching in regards to when the church was charging people to get out of purgatory. Right. And I didn't really have a good answer for him. I thought that it was a scandal and they had gotten in trouble for that, but I didn't want to misrepresent the teaching.
Yes.
So I'm kind of asking for a friend so I can answer correctly, and I think he's listening as well.
Yes, great. Well, first of all, it is a popular myth, but it is a myth nonetheless, that the church ever taught that you can buy someone out of purgatory. That is a myth. In fact, even the abuses and the abusers, there was a famous Dominican priest by the name of Johann Tetzel, who became very famous and abused historically, even though he was slapped down by the church. They told him to knock it off. His theology, he wasn't teaching you can buy someone out of purgatory, but he was teaching a very mechanical, it was in the context of raising money for the building of what we call today the Vatican. He was preaching, and when he preached on indulgences, he had the famous line, you remember, Cy, where he said, as the coin tinkle or rings in the bottom of the can, a soul, I don't think I got that exactly right, a soul will spring.
He said in German, though.
Yeah, so, that's right.
So you don't have to get it too right.
A soul will spring from purgatory. Now, of course, the idea of you and I praying for the souls of the dead, those that are in purgatory, goes back even before the time of Christ. We know, for example, in 2 Maccabees 12:46, we read about the ancient Jews already had this belief, the context being the Maccabean revolt, where they were fighting the war there to liberate the people of God and the temple from the oppressors, Antiochus IV and such. And they lost a battle, and as they were surveying the dead soldiers and such, they discovered they had little amulets under their tunics or whatever it was that they were wearing, and they discerned, that's why we lost the battle. And so they took up a collection that an offering could be made for these fallen soldiers in Jerusalem, and they did a good, as verse 46 says, they did a good and wholesome thing in praying, offering sacrifice for the souls of the dead, which is an indicator that we believe, just as you see in Catholic theology today, very similarly, they didn't have the same language that we have today. But in fact, it's funny you call, because I was just reading an ancient Jewish apocryphal work called the Apocrypha of Zephaniah. I just read it today. I was answering somebody's question. Isn't it something, you just read something and it comes up?
Yes, I hear that all the time, yeah.
But in the Apocalypse of Zephaniah, you see spoken about three distinct sort of states of being after death. That is hell, and in fact there, if you go to the place of the damned, there is no hope for you. In fact, there's that, you know, actually the image in the apocryphal, that apocryphal work, the apocalypse of Zephaniah, there's like the images of a boat. You have this sort of gulf there, and you can't penetrate to those who are in hell. There's no help for them. But you also have, very similar to what we see when Jesus teaches his parable of Lazarus and the rich man, you have the rich man who is in hell, and there's an impenetrable gulf between him and Abraham and the souls that are in the that are righteous, and they can't help him. That's what you see in the apocalypse of Zephaniah. And so you have the righteous, but the place of the righteous is divided into those who were pure, and the Apocrypha of Zephaniah, say that five times fast. The Apocrypha of Zephaniah depicts that. You have souls being purified, and then you have the pure ones who are in no more need of purification, like Abraham. Okay, so at any rate, this is what we're talking about, is the purification for those who die not in a state of mortal sin, because if you die in a state of mortal sin, you go to hell for all eternity, and there is no second chance. In fact, purgatory is not a second chance. This is the place for people, most of us, who will die with some either punishment due for sin, venial sins on our souls that have to be purified fully. That's what is spoken of in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 11 through 15, where St. Paul talks about the final judgment, where you have those who still have the symbol being wood, hay, and stubble, imperfections on their souls, versus gold, silver, precious stones that don't need purification. You have the wood, hay, and stubble that needs to be burned up. And those souls are saved, says St. Paul in verse 15, but only as through fire. Okay, and so when it gets to the idea of indulgences, the idea is here that the prayers, the sacrifices, the prayer, fasting, almsgiving, especially now as we've come to the end here of the season of Lent, where we really focus a lot on this, we need to understand, and very much rooted, not just in the Old Testament, but the New Testament. Jesus himself says, for example, in Luke chapter 11, verse 41, he says, "Behold, give alms, and all things are pure unto you." That's Jesus most likely referring back to the book of Tobit, where the book of Tobit in chapter 4 uses almost the same language, that the giving of alms purifies from all sins. So it's not just almsgiving. All sacrifices that we offer to God in and through Jesus Christ are meritorious. This is basically a foundational principle of how we can pray for one another, and those prayers are effectual. It's because we're in Jesus Christ. It's not by our power, but the power of Jesus Christ working in us and through us that can affect transformation, healing, temporal goods, as well as, you know, salvation. So when we're talking about indulgences, we're talking about the living, making sacrifices, prayer, alms. Now, when it, you know, prayer, fasting, almsgiving, or any sacrifice, as I said. Now, in the 16th century, the alms, they were called alms indulgences, were the sticking point. And in fact, the Fifth Lateran Council had dealt with it, 5 years before Luther's Here I Stand. And the church was dealing with the fact that you had these guys like Tetzel. And again, his theology wasn't incorrect. He was just, he was kind of like, I look at him like the modern TV preacher.
He was, yeah.
You know, I mean, yeah. He was just really, he was extravagant in his presentation. He's getting people to give. But he made it mechanical to where if you right. do the act, the soul springs free out
That's
of
it.
Purgatory.
As soon as the coin in the coffer
clings
the soul from purgatory springs.
Springs. Yeah. I don't know how that rhymes in German, but yeah.
Clinging and springing.
that's our English version. Anyway, you're right. And so, you know, the key is to understand Tetzel was wrong, and he was called on the he was called on it because he was, what he was doing was bad. And here we are hundreds of years later, and it's still bad and still being used against the church, unfortunately. But of course, our offerings for the souls of the dead are only effectual if they're done in Jesus Christ, in Him, with Him, and through Him. And the church is very, very clear on this, that we have to offer these prayers. We must be in a state of grace, and there are certain things we must do, the church says, in order for these things to be effectual. Now, indulgences per se are rooted in this understanding that you and I, as members of the body of Christ, can help one another. One of my favorite texts that gets at this is 1 John chapter 5, verse 16, where St. John says, if any man sees his brother sin, a sin that is not mortal. I mean, there you have it. One of the plainest texts concerning mortal and venial sin. Now, the Protestant versions and modern versions will say not unto death. And that's a good translation because it is ace thanaton, unto death, not unto death. So would that be may ace thanaton, not unto death. He says, if any man sees his brother sin, a sin which is not unto death, I say pray for him and life will be communicated. Life will be given to the one whose sin is not mortal. Very plain text there in 1 John, that if we offer sacrifices, we pray for another member of the body of Christ. Now, mind you, they have to be members of the body of Christ. Notice he says, if you see your brother sinning, right? He's talking about us making atonement for our brother's sins. And in order for that to be effectual, he has to be in Christ. Because remember, we're members of the body of Christ. We can heal one another. That's why St. Paul uses that beautiful metaphor in both Romans 12 and 1 Corinthians 12. That it can the eye say to the hand, I have no need of thee? Can the head say to the foot, I have no need of thee? The answer is no. We all need each other as members of the body of Christ. Think of it this way. If my finger gets wounded, what does the rest of the body do? The body immediately sends, you know, coagulants, antibodies, taking care of infection, and so forth in that finger. That's the body of Christ. Other members of the body can affect healing in that member whose sin, and here's the key, brother, 1 John 5:16, whose sin is not mortal. But then he says, but if the sin is mortal or unto death, I say not that you should pray for that. Now, that doesn't mean you can't pray for the person to be restored to repentance. Of course, the context is, he just said you can directly atone for the sin. You can communicate life. And the Greek word there is zoe. If you pray for that brother whose sin is not unto death, life will be given to him. The Greek word zoe, not bios, the natural life, but zoe, the divine life of God will be communicated to that one whose sin is not mortal. But if the sin is mortal, no, you can't help them, at least not in that same way of directly communicating that divine life and healing. No, they are, if they commit a sin that is unto death, that is a mortal sin, they're cut off from the body of Christ. And we have a sacrament for that, right? And that's called confession. If you're not a Christian yet, we have a sacrament called baptism, where you're incorporated into Christ, and then you can experience all of this life-giving love in the body of Christ. After baptism, if you're cut off through mortal sin, we have another sacrament given to us by Jesus, confession, whereby you can be restored to communion, reattached. That finger got cut off.
To the body.
Now reattached to the body, hence they have that communication of divine life. Now, the beautiful thing about indulgences is exercising the keys of the kingdom of heaven that Jesus promised to St. Peter and his successors, the popes. This is the church invoking the communion of saints, the infinite merits of Christ and the merits of all of the saints, so that they come to our assistance in these acts of sacrificial love that we make for one another, so that our prayers and our sacrifices are, you might say, supercharged, right? so that, and this is the beautiful gift of being in the church, the gift of the keys of the kingdom, you know, and a lot of folks don't realize that Matthew chapter 16, verse 18, and other of the Petrine texts don't only deal with Jesus giving Peter and his successors, the popes, a declaratory power. Right? Matthew 16, when Jesus promised Peter the keys, and he says, you know, whatever you, singular, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. That does represent a declaratory power where the Pope declares something definitively, and it has the power of heaven to back it up. But it also refers to the remission of sins. As, you know, the Catechism of the Catholic Church tells us in section 1445 and elsewhere, so that that involves the keys of the kingdom in the confessional. And all of the priests sort of participate in that which the Pope has first and in a unique way. But they all participate in the absolving of sins. But now that can absolve the eternal punishment of sin. The priest can absolve you of the eternal punishment of sin, right? That will set you back on a course toward heaven, but it can also deal with the temporal punishment due for sins, and that's where indulgences come in, where the Pope declares that if you do certain actions, you know, and that's, you know, what we're talking about with indulgences. Let's say, for example, as we see Pope St. Paul VI, one of the many that he gave, blessed the church with, if you say a rosary in front of the exposed Blessed Sacrament in a community, right? You can gain what's called a plenary indulgence. Now, you have to meet all the criteria. You have to pray for the Pope. You have to go to confession within roughly a week of doing that penitential act. And the hard part is you have to, in order to gain a plenary indulgence, you have to be free of all attachment to sin, both mortal and venial. So that's a lot. It's a high bar, and we can never know if we've actually attained it in this life, but we can have moral certainty that we at least attain a partial indulgence. Now, a plenary indulgence means the remission of the entirety of one soul's temporal punishment due for sin. A partial means just partial. Right? So I know we've gone kind of a long way into this about indulgences, but when we understand that all of this is entirely biblical, and it's basically rooted in Jesus Christ speaking through his church and exhorting us to love one another, to offer prayers and sacrifices for each other, understanding that souls are on the line, whether eternal souls at times, by our cooperation with God's grace in bringing other to Jesus Christ, bringing them to the sacraments for salvation and such, or the remission of temporal punishment due for sins. It's really about all of us as members of the body of Christ loving one another and offering that healing to one another through the wonderful gifts that God has given us in the church.
Zach, thank you very much for the call. It's an open forum for non-Catholics, and indulgences is certainly among the things that non-Catholics ask us about, but maybe you've got one you'd like to ask Tim Staples, himself a convert to the Catholic faith. 888-318-7884 is the number. Tim and Valerie Staples on the 20th of April will be in Independence, Ohio.
There it is.
For the Spiritual Blessings of Marriage conference. Lots of great speakers. And then you said candlelight dinner for couples?
Yeah, it's going to be quite beautiful. We're looking forward to it.
Go to marriagesofgrace.org, marriagesofgrace.org, and sign up. If you're in the Ohio area and you can make it, it starts at noon and goes till 9 p.m. So that's actually a great, if you're going to do a marriage thing, get it done in one day so that people can dedicate the time and
Amen.
And then do the other things they got to do. But it ends with a dinner, so a candlelight dinner for the two of you. Go and get renewed. Marriagesofgrace.org. The number here is 888-318-7884. If you are not a Catholic and you have a question about the Catholic faith, this is your opportunity to call. Mark is in Texas. listening to EWTN on Sirius XM Satellite Radio. That's channel 130. Mark, go ahead with your question for Tim.
Yes, Tim. Yes. Hi, I'm 62. I'm not a Catholic. I was raised Episcopal. I was baptized and confirmed. It's actually kind of a, now what I know of, it's kind of an Anglo-Catholic parish.
Okay.
Because the priest was actually, the way we learned Eucharist was transubstantiation.
Ah, so you're close, but Mark, I messed up. I had you ask your question too close to the break, and I cannot change this one. This is the hard break. So we'll get your question for Tim when we come back right after this. 888-318-7884, the number, open forum for non-Catholics on Catholic Answers Live.
This year, the Catholic Answers Conference turns to the parables, sermons, and conversations of Jesus Christ. Join special guests Scott and Kimberly Hahn, Dr. Ray Guarendi, and an all-star lineup of speakers September 26th through 29th. Spend time with your favorite Catholic Answers apologists and our special guests right here in beautiful San Diego. Seats are still available, but going fast. Use promo code EARLY to save $50 and register today at CatholicAnswersConference.com.
If you're not a Bible scholar, the full message of how the Sunday Mass readings fit together can be tough to comprehend. Apologist Carlo Broussard is here to help. Join Carlo every Friday for the Sunday Catholic Word Podcast. In each episode, he unpacks the scripture readings for that Sunday and brings them all together so you can better understand and defend the faith. Visit SundayCatholicWord.com to subscribe. That's SundayCatholicWord.com.
Is Orthodoxy an alternative to the Catholic Church? In a time of uncertainty for many Catholics, Orthodoxy can look like greener pastures. Answering Orthodoxy, the new book from Catholic Answers Press, explains why Catholics who are thinking of leaving need to think twice. There are important reasons to remain in the Catholic Church and convincing answers to Orthodox claims. Order your copy of Answering Orthodoxy today at shop.catholic.com or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Our Lord needs articulate defenders of the truth to spread the joy of the Catholic faith. Catholic Answers Monthly Giving Club, Society 315, helps you fulfill the call in 1 Peter 3:15 to always be prepared to make a defense for the hope that is in you. For as little as $10 a month, you'll help Catholics grow in faith, bring lapsed Catholics home, and lead non-Catholics to the truth. Go to CASociety315.com and join today.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm not doing a very good job with the clock today. I'll admit it, not doing a very good job with the clock. I didn't give Mark time to ask his question before we had to go to the break. So we'll go to Mark in Texas, who's listening to EWTN on channel 130 Sirius XM Satellite Radio. But Mark, I have to do this before I can let you ask your question, and that is remind people that March is almost over, and Chris Check came in and told me, don't forget to let people know that break on the cabins for the Catholic Answers Cruise ends the last day of March. So if you want the $150 off per ticket, now is the time to go to CatholicAnswersCruise.com. We're cruising in June, June 29th through July 6th, leaving from Montreal, ending up in Boston.
And I've been on that cruise.
It's beautiful up there, isn't it?
It is gorgeous. So, folks, don't miss it.
Just go to CatholicAnswersCruise.com. Check it out. And if you want the $150 off whatever tickets you buy, then just use the promo code LAST150 because this is your last chance to get that $150 off. Mark is in Texas, as I said. Mark, I'm so sorry that I had to interrupt you with that, but go ahead with your question for Tim.
Sure, thanks. I was giving you a little bit of background. So, I mean, I was raised as an Episcopal. I married a good Baptist girl. We've been married 42 years now. We've been going to, at this point, a non-denominational church, which is very close to what the Baptist teachings were. Bottom line, something's been missing in my spiritual life for a long, long time.
Yeah.
And for several months, I've been found Catholic radio, found EWTN, have read through the bishop's U.S. Catechism for adults.
Okay, great.
Studying, been reading, working through an introduction to a devout life, and great. Something's just, I mean, at this point has really clicked.
Yeah.
And I know that my personal faith needs to be with the Catholic Church.
Yeah.
The issue is my wife's raised Baptist, and she's very staunch on once saved, always saved. And
right.
If it ain't in the Bible, it ain't true.
Right.
And I've worked myself into a conscience issue here.
Yeah.
And so I'm just trying to wonder, what are some things that I can do to help, not
yeah.
necessarily convert my wife, but at least sure. let her understand why I'm where I'm at.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I think you're already doing that, brother, and God bless you. So you say the Episcopalian background was more an Anglo-Catholic background you had? Because you mentioned they taught transubstantiation. Is that correct?
That is correct. Yeah, the priest that,
yeah.
that you know, worked through our confirmation, he presented it as transubstantiation.
Yeah, that's beautiful.
So that's always kind of where I carried it until I got, you know, obviously in the Baptist church, that's
sure.
thrown out. But,
oh, yeah. that's a very small minority among the Anglican communion as well, and the Episcopalians in the United States, but it's beautiful. I had a dear friend who was an Anglo-Catholic priest, and he is now Catholic, and he's now a philosophy professor and just a great guy. But here, I think the key, my friend, is if you've listened to this broadcast for long, you've probably heard me say this before, but I really do think we as Catholics need to learn how to scratch where it itches. You know what I mean? Because only the person you're talking to, only your wife can tell you where she itches, and then you scratch it. And so I think you're already on to something when you tell me that she's all about once saved, always saved, and that sort of thing. That might be the place to start. You know, if you have an opportunity to share the faith, and it sounds like she's pretty passionate about her faith, so that might be an area to look into. And we've got a tremendous amount of helps here at Catholic Answers for you. I don't know if you're aware of, we have a great book here put out by one of our apologists, Trent Horn, called Why We're Catholic. Do you have that book, by the way?
No, I haven't heard of it.
Well, I'll tell you what, I'd like to send a free copy out to you because it's a fantastic overview of what we believe as Catholics. And it's from an apologetics perspective, but it's really, I think he did an extraordinary job. It's very simply written, but covers a lot of ground, including the issue that's most important to your wife being a Baptist, and that is salvation and the idea of once saved, always saved. Because what I find is, and I did this, and I don't know if you know this either, but my entire family, my mother, father, three brothers, two sisters-in-law, nieces, nephews, all of them weren't Catholic when I converted, and now they're all Catholic, you know, and it wasn't because of me. It was the grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I always want to make that clear because I screwed up about every way you could in evangelizing, but God brought them all home. And that's what I tell you, what I did is I would always let my father, my mother, my brothers determine what we were going to talk about because I wanted to talk about what they wanted to talk about, not what I wanted to talk about. And I find that to be effectual. And so when they had that question, you know, about salvation, well, come on, man. What you find, my brother, is the Catholic position is so biblically rooted. It's extraordinary. That part of my odyssey to the Catholic faith, and this includes the Marian dogmas like the Assumption and the Immaculate Conception. And I know a lot of Catholics will say, well, that's not really in the Bible. Yes, it is. You know, it's not there explicit. Neither is the Trinity, right? I mean, so much of what we believe is not there explicit, but it is absolutely, there's nothing in the Bible that contradicts any of the doctrines of our faith, and there's so much that affirms it, right? And I'll just share with you a brief story of when I was in the throes of studying Catholicism. It was when I was serving the United States Marine Corps, and I met this Catholic fellow who really knew his faith, and he was the first Catholic who had ever really given me intelligent, biblical, historical reasons for the faith. And when I hit him with justification by faith alone, right, not by works, and that's probably the biggest point for our Baptist friends. They agree with Martin Luther, who said justification is the doctrine upon which the church rises or falls. That was Luther himself. And you find that Baptists, and I'm sure you'd agree with me because I was born and raised a Southern Baptist, or at least I was raised Southern Baptist, and it was huge for me. But I'll never forget talking with my buddy Matt Dula, and he said, all right, Tim, so you believe in the Bible alone? I said, amen, brother. And you believe in justification by faith alone? I said, amen, brother, not of works, lest any man boast, right? As Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9 says, for by grace you have been saved. Different words, salvation there versus justification, like in Romans 4:5 and elsewhere. But it's the same principle, right? We're justified by faith alone. We're saved by faith alone, by grace alone, through faith alone. That's what I was raised with. And so he was kind of going on the offensive with me, and he said, okay, so you believe we're justified by faith alone. Well, Tim, let me just take you to James chapter 2, verse 24, right? Now, brother, I'm sure you probably know what I'm about to do here, but this was important because even though I knew what he was about to do, I knew the verse, and I knew how I was going to respond to it, but I'd never had a Catholic present it to me, and man, this guy, he was just... we would use the term anointed with the power of the Holy Spirit. He really was. Wow. This guy was Matt Dula, daily communicant, daily rosary. And he said, Tim, here's what the Bible says. We see then that a man is justified by works and not by faith alone. And then he looked me in the eye and he said, Tim, I'm not asking you to become Catholic, but I'm just saying, can you at least understand why I, as a Catholic, might have a little problem with justification by faith alone, when the only place in the whole Bible the words faith alone are found, the words not by are right in front of them. And then he takes me to Matthew chapter 12. He's like, it's not just James, but go to Matthew chapter 12, verse 36 and 37, where Jesus himself, in the context of the final judgment that he teaches on in verse 36, he then says, by your words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned. Right? Now, words is more than just faith.
Yeah.
Words is something you have to say, something you have to do. He's like, Tim, how can I reject the Bible for some teaching of Martin Luther 500 years ago? I'm sorry, Tim, I've got to go with sacred scripture on things like that. And he didn't stop there. And this is what I recommend to folks, especially if you're talking about a Bible-believing, right, Christian, go to Romans chapter 2, verses 6 and 7, where St. Paul says, God will reward each man according to his works. To him who continues in good works, his reward shall be glory, incorruption, and eternal life. Eternal life is the reward for good works. Now, obviously, these are works done in Christ, not our own, because, of course, it's not of ourselves. It's the gift of God, as we already saw in Ephesians chapter 2. But we have to, you know, choose to open the gift and to work with the gifts that God gives us and be faithful with those gifts. And that's why Paul will say, I'll give you another text, in Galatians 6, verses 7 through 9, St. Paul says, be not deceived, God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man sows, that shall he reap. If a man continues to sow to the flesh, he shall of the flesh reap death. But if he continues to sow to the Spirit, he shall of the Spirit reap everlasting life. Therefore, do not grow weary in doing good, knowing you will reap the reward. What reward? Eternal life. If you faint not. Man, it was texts like that And then Revelation 2:10, which I mentioned earlier on this broadcast. Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. You see, there's a causal relationship. This isn't, you know, as some Protestants will say, you know, these texts are just descriptive. They're not prescriptive. You don't have to do good works. This is just describing somebody who's saved. They will do good works. But that's not what these texts say. They say the reward for good works is eternal life, you see? And so we as Catholics, we take all of these scriptures. When the scripture talks about salvation, justification being a gift and something that we cannot merit, we agree. When it comes to the grace of God, the initial gift of salvation that we're given by Jesus Christ, there is nothing we can do to merit it whatsoever. That's why Paul says what he says in Ephesians 2, 8, and 9, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Right? We agree with that. However, look at verse 10, the next verse. He then says, for we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus unto good works. Once we enter into Christ, then we must get to working, right? To cooperate with the grace of God. And if we do and endure to the end, we'll be saved. Anyway, I know I've given you a lot to think about there, but I'll tell you what, I highly suggest that you start where she wants to start. Live your faith number one and be a servant to her. And then I guarantee it, and you pray hard and ask the Holy Spirit to open the doors, and you share. You just plant the seeds in love. Don't yell. Don't get mad, because that's the worst thing you can do, right? God opposes the proud and gives grace to the humble, and God will take care of the rest.
Mark, thanks. Got to take a quick break. Right back with more Open Forum for non-Catholics on this Monday of Holy Week with Tim Staples on Catholic Answers Live.
It's all about the truth. Catholic Answers Live.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
The wisdom of Mother Angelica.
You know, I have never seen women who want to be equal absolutely degrading themselves. And yet the media degrades your nature, your beauty as a woman, your goodness. Let us pray at some point our dear Lord touches their hearts.
For more information on Mother Angelica, visit Religious Catalog at EWTNRC.com.
The Catechism defines evangelization as the proclamation of Christ and his gospel by word and the testimony of life. But what does that look like in real life? It looks like St. Paul street evangelists out in the public square sharing the good news. We're a Catholic nonprofit that starts conversations by handing out free sacramentals. Then we employ our method of listen, befriend, proclaim, and invite. Catholic Answers is supported in part by St. Paul Street Evangelization. Visit streetevangelization.com to learn more.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. It's Open Forum for non-Catholics. Tim Staples, our guest this hour. And one thing we want to get right and make sure we don't mess up on, and not that you, I'm not saying anybody messed up on it, because that's not the case, but that we got to be careful with indulgences, because that's one that people have quite strong feelings about.
It is. And I wanted to mention for our caller, because I got into kind of a lengthy discourse on indulgences, but the one thing I realized that I failed to do was really get to what was an important part of the question. So I hope you're still listening, brother, when I share with you. I laid out the theology of indulgences and how it's entirely biblical. But the real issue, the controversy, was over what I mentioned but didn't really explain, alms indulgences.
Oh, yeah.
Because, you know, before this time in the church, and as far back as you want to go, the church included within, if we're going to lay out a category of the kinds of indulgences. Indulgences could include doing things like praying, saying rosaries, saying particular prayers, fasting, right? And almsgiving. And I mentioned, Cy, that the almsgiving was where the problem came in, especially with Tetzel. And it wasn't just Tetzel. There were some others, but Tetzel became the most famous.
He's like the poster boy.
Johann Tetzel. Yes, he was the poster boy for what you don't do when you're presenting the truth of indulgences. But the church determined, even though it's absolutely theologically correct, I mentioned, you know, Luke 11:41, where Jesus gives us a very important principle of indulgences: behold, give alms and all things are clean to you, rooted right, you know, in Tobit chapter 4 from the Old Testament. The idea, not just Tobit, I mean, all over the place, the Psalms, you bring your sacrifices, and it merits the forgiveness with God and so forth. I mean, even, I you know, it popped in my head, I think it's Proverbs 16:3, that says friendship, you can atone for sins just acting as a friend. That is sacrificial love between brothers, and you atone for sins, right? I mean, it's all over the place in the Bible. But when it comes to almsgiving, what happened was, like with Tetzel, that famous line that Cy said, as soon as the coin in the canister clings, a soul from purgatory springs. The false impression was that you're buying someone out of purgatory. Now, it didn't help, Cy, that in the post-Luther period, you had Protestants who were embellishing and outright lying and saying things, you know, like you could pay for. I remember this one pseudo-document that was proliferated for hundreds of years, and you'll still find it online, talking about you can buy adultery. And they were saying preemptively,
yeah,
you could pay a certain amount of money and then go ahead and have all the adultery you want. You know, before, I mean, all of that was absolutely mythical. There was no Catholic preacher that was that far gone. That's not what they were teaching. Certainly wasn't what Tetzel was teaching. But the appearance became so problematic that giving alms associated with the remission of temporal punishment due for sin, that the church determined we're not going to do that anymore. Now, you can still offer, and every time you offer your alms in church or alms to the poor, the same principle applies. That is a sacrifice that is, that is meritorious if it's offered in Christ for the remission of sins. Absolutely, that is theologically sound. But the church said we're not going to offer it as an indulgence any longer because the misunderstanding was just too great. And, you know, even though I was talking to Cy about this during the break, I love the idea of alms indulgences because it's so profoundly biblical. This isn't one of the many examples of Holy Mother Church being concerned for her children, and not just her children within the parameters of the Catholic Church, but all the sons and daughters of God who don't know Jesus yet. We don't want to put up obstacles to them either. And so we did away with that, and we need to catechize people correctly on the nature of indulgences, and perhaps sometime in the future the church will restore alms indulgences. But
as long as people, it would have to maintain a kind of clarity so people can't be exploited.
Exactly.
All right, Brianne, I think that's right. Brianne in Missouri watching on YouTube. Did I say that right? Is it Brianne?
Yes.
Hello, Brianne. Go ahead with your question for Tim.
I'm actually technically non-Catholic, but I am Protestant converting.
Okay, God bless you.
That's okay.
Yes, that's what I was trying to say at the beginning. Whatever, we're going to go easy on the rules. Like, but so okay. go ahead, Brianne.
I actually have a cousin whose father, I get confused about that. He's also my cousin, I suppose, had a very serious burn accident happen a couple of days ago, and he's in hospital right now in critical condition. He is not a man of faith at all, right, or even of virtue.
Right.
But I just wonder if it's allowed or appropriate to request, with the family's permission, for a priest to come visit him. Would he be able to, if he wants to make a confession, to receive last rites? Or does, I mean,
right,
in that condition?
Well, Breanne, you can certainly make a request for a priest to come visit him. And I happen to know lots of priests who would love that opportunity to come visit him. Now, in order to receive a sacrament in the church, and last rites includes a sacrament or sacraments in the plural, he would have to make a profession of faith to say he believes, like the Catholic Church teaches with regard to these sacraments. Then the church is very, very lenient when it comes to people that are in danger of death. So if he were to make known to the priest that he agrees with the Catholic Church on these sacraments, he certainly could. But it, you know, if it's the case that he doesn't want a priest there, he doesn't agree, then the priest could certainly pray with him, pray for him, and such. But in order to receive a sacrament, you do have to acknowledge the faith. Does that make sense?
Yes, of course.
Yeah, yeah. But certainly, you know, I would request a priest to come see him. But, you know, you might want to ask him as well, does he want a priest to come? Because if he doesn't, now, I don't know if he's, is he conscious?
I don't know if he is. He just came out of surgery that he wasn't expected to survive. So
Okay. We've
gotten a step closer to.
Right. So you can have a priest come if he's not conscious. A priest will. A priest can come and pray over him. And you can't lose when you have the power of prayer at work in your corner. If he is conscious, then, of course, you'd want to know that, you know, you don't want to have a priest come in and then the guy says, I don't want this priest, in, you know, and that sort of thing.
Who will rid me of this meddlesome priest? Breanne?
Of course.
Yeah.
And you're coming into the church at Easter or another time?
No, I was a little, my conversion process started like in December. So my local priest is actually kind of helping me.
Beautiful.
Kind of sponsoring me.
Great.
So
beautiful.
I'm not quite there yet.
Well, you say it like it's bad that it started in December. It, you know, people come to the Catholic faith every day of the year. So you can start anytime you want. You're always welcome.
Oh, sure. Yeah. No, I'm anxious. I just am not. I didn't get in fast enough to do it at Easter.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you what. I'd like to send you a copy of Tim's book, Behold Your Mother, A Biblical and Historical Defense of the Marian Doctrines. I think that you'll like it, and I'd just like to give you a little gift. I'm going to go kind of quick over to Bob, though, in Minnesota, watching on YouTube. Bob, if you can be quick with your question, we can get Tim to get you an answer. Bob?
Hello, Bob. Bob?
Let me try him again. This would be called Rebob. Bob? No, Bob's not coming.
Did we lose Bob?
I'll tell you what. Tim and Valerie Staples, April 20th, are going to be speaking up. You're going to speak too, Valerie? Valerie's in the studio with us now.
Yes.
You both be speaking in Ohio, in Independence, Ohio. And do you know the URL, Valerie?
I should have got that piece of paper.
You should have got that piece of paper. Let me find it. Let me see if I can find it here. But this is a good one. It ends with a. You know, you get to have a Marriages of Grace. You go to marriagesofgrace.org and you can find out all about it.
There you go.
Tim, I don't know if we'll see you again this week. So very blessed Holy Week and Easter to you and your family.
Yeah, I don't think you will. So, wow, can you believe Lent is over already?
If any of the kids get anything in their Easter basket that they don't want, just let them know. I'm available.
All right, brother.
I'm available to help.
And happy Holy Week to everyone. Have a blessed blessed Easter.
Amen, amen. All right, well, that'll do it for us. Don't forget that you can come on the cruise with us still. You know, March is almost over, so I want to keep saying that. Just check out CatholicAnswersCruise.com. Use the promo code LAST150 if you want to get $150 off before the last day of this month, midnight Honolulu time. We'll see you tomorrow, God willing, right here on Catholic Answers Live.